Hi everyone. Today the chapter that we are going to do today is the Indian Constitution. Constitution we have discussed so many times what it is. Today we will discuss about it in detail, covering each and every aspect accordingly and then few more things. So this is a picture that shows the Indian Constitution, all the important people who were involved after the freedom that we got after a long British rule and the Constitution that was made. So these were the people involved. They are the primary sources from where we got the constitution, which we called as a set of rules that governs the country. What are we going to discuss is the basic introduction that we always do. Why does a country need a constitution? That is a big question. And we will talk about our constitution and its key features. So in this slide, if you see that there is a football match that is being played. Now there is a question that must be, you all must be thinking is that from constitution, why am I shifted to the football match? It's not just about football match, it's about any sports, anything. What happens? What are the basic thing that is required when you go and play a sport? That are, or those are called as the rules. Rules are the basic things that are required to play any sport and to get success. So we can say that rules are the fundamentals for any successful game, because if there are no rules, then how will we decide that who has won and who has lost the match? It is not just about the cricket match. It can be about the polo match or a football match or a cricket, whoever, whatsoever game you thought of that has some certain set of rules, and those are designed to ensure that a game is played in a fair way. Similarly, our societies, they also have some constitutive rules. As I say that constitution is a set of written documents and these rules were formulated out of consensus. So here I say this thing that all the people who were involved in the formation of the constitution, those who wrote all the rules and regulations in the constitution, were the ones who fought against the Britishers and gave us the freedom. And that is why they faced, since they faced each and every problem practically, they know that these could be the probable solutions. A written document containing constitutive rules is what we called as a constitution, and every state in country is governed by these rules. So that means a constitution is a national document, because all the countries of any particular, all the states of any particular country are ruled and regulated by using these principles, the rules and regulations that are written in this book of constitution. Now the next thing is, why does a country need a constitution? Okay, by now we have understood that what is a constitution? That it is a book that needs, that has some rules and regulations. The question is that why does we need a constitution, or why do any country needs a constitution? And we say that every democratic country is likely to have a constitution. But it is not necessary that all the countries, those who have a constitution, are democratic. Now, these are two very opposite statements, I know, but we need to understand this thing, that a country that is a democratic country should have a constitution. Why? Because there are some rules and regulations which everybody should follow, and that is not by choice, that they have to follow. For this purpose, a constitution is written. But then there are certain countries, they may have a constitution, but there's no guarantee that they are democratic. Relation between constitution and a country. Now we'll quickly go through the study of Nepal and we'll see that what happens over there and why is a constitution so necessary for a country, or why every democratic country should have a constitution. It's like Nepal fought freedom struggle in 1990 because people were really upset with the monarchy level of government which they were having in their country. So they started to raise their voice against the current system of the government. Till 1991, Nepal was having a monarchy form of government. This I have already discussed with you. Then in 1991, Nepali Congress launched a movement to establish a multi-party parliament. A multi-party parliament means a parliament that has all the political parties which are existing in the country. And democracy was established and it lasted for 12 years until 2002. So they launched a movement. It was a monarchy country. Then they launched a movement With all the efforts of the people, finally it became democratic, and that democracy was retained by the people for 12 years. What happened after that? Then in October 2002, King Gyanendra Singh took over the government, because it is a monarchy form of government, and in a monarchy either a king rules or a queen rules. So in Nepal, after 12 years of democratic government, King Gyanendra came and he took over the government with the assistance of the army. In 2005, Gyanendra took over as the head of the government. So for after 12 years, first he took over the government and then he waited for 3 years. And that was all by force. When I say that with the help of the army, that means it was not by the people's choice. He did it by the force. He used army and he took the government. And after 3 years, he also took as the government head. Then in 2006, again, the people started the movement for the democracy because they were really tortured by the monarchy form of government. They were not happy. In April 2006, the king restored the third parliament and asked the political parties to form a government. This is the entire story that we are using and we are listening and understanding that this happened in Nepal. In 2007, Nepal adopted an interim constitution and Nepal gained political freedom. People's movement protesting in Nepal against monarchy. So these are the few pictures which are showing that how people protested against monarchy. And this is the people's voice that can even change the form of government. This we have discussed in the previous chapters also, if you can recall, that it is the duty of the government to give proper facilities to the people in a democratic country. And if they fail to do so, there are many other ways wherein people can use their powers and can call off the government. So same happened over here. People were really frustrated with the monarchy form of government, and that is why they protested. Now, people of Nepal wanted a new constitution for the following reasons. Earlier there was an interim constitution, but that interim constitution was not giving all the basic rights, responsibilities and freedoms that the people of Nepal wanted. So that is why they wanted a new constitution. And what were the reasons behind them is, first of all, that Nepal was no longer a monarchy country. In the monarchy country, Nepal constitution powers were entirely in the hands of the king. And that is why it is called as interim constitution. Then the people of Nepal wanted a new constitution because now the ideals of the people changed. They wanted something new and they wanted to discard everything that was old. In the previous constitution, which was adopted in 1990, in that the final authority was just with the king. The people of Nepal fought for democratic government for many years, and in 2006, finally, they succeeded in putting an end to the monarchy form of government. And then later on, a new constitution was there which established Nepal as a democratic country along with new ideals. We always need a new constitution, or they needed a new constitution, because first of all, it has certain sets of rules and principles. And it also safeguards against the misuse of authority by the political leaders. Otherwise, these are the people who play an influential role in writing of the constitution. They will write it in a way that favors them. And that is why once the government form of government changes, always a new constitution is designed. Now, this is a short conversational story. Quickly, we'll go through and we'll try to understand what was the outcome. So this is a scene of a class where kids are standing and a teacher is saying something to the kids. The moment the teacher enters, it started scolding a child. The name of the child is Anil, and the teacher says, "Today I am going to report you to Mrs. Rao." And the boy asks that, "What have I done, ma'am?" Now the other child starts explaining that, "Ma'am, while you were away, Anil kept talking loudly and he was disturbing the whole class." And the monitor, who, you know, if the teacher leaves for a minute, for 5 minutes, if she has to go for some urgent thing, she nominates her child to think and to take over the class and to take care of the class for 5 minutes. So when ma'am came, the boy told her, narrated her the entire thing, that when you were away, this boy did not listen to me and he was talking loudly. "Anil, you will have to stay back and you will have to write this thing 100 times that I will not disobey the class monitor." "But ma'am, I did not do anything." See, in this situation, ma'am was not there. Ma'am did not know actually that what happened. No other child was there to support Anil. And just ma'am formed an opinion on the basis of the feedback of the class monitor. None of us know the truth because we were not there. So how can we decide that the person is wrong just by statement of some other person? Now, from this entire story, what have we concluded is that we need a constitution, or any democratic country needs a constitution to ensure that a dominant group does not use its power against others. Because over here, what was happening? Maybe the entire class was the friend of class monitor and they did not like Anil. So what did they do? They thought of a plan that today teacher has given me the authority. When teacher comes back, I am going to narrate her false stories and today I will put Anil in trouble. And somehow he was successful in whatever he planned. And second reason that why do we have a constitution is that majority should not overlook the interest of the minority. Over here, the two terms that we have used, majority and minority. Majority is that section of the society where people are more in number, and minority means less in number. It could be in relation to any particular caste, it could be in relation to any particular sex. Like, you know, if a class has out of 20 students, if a class has 15 boys and 5 girls, so we say that the majority of the students in this class are boys and minority are girls. Again, we'll have a short interesting story and we'll try to understand the outcome. The games period is about to begin. So the first group says, let's play basketball. So the second group says, no, let's play cricket. And the teacher decides to settle the problem with a show of hands. And the second group won. So they started teasing the first group that we have won. And the boy gave the reason that obviously because we have more boys in the class. So what happens is like girls wanted to play a different game, boys wanted to play a different game. And just because boys were in majority, finally the game that the boys wanted to play were chosen by everybody as the game to be played in the sports period. We always have to do so. Now they are having a normal conversation. They say that we always have to do so because boys are in majority. That is why we are forced to do whatever they want to do. Now the other girl is giving an explanation to the teacher and she is saying that, ma'am, we should think of another ways of making the decision so that even our wishes are heard. Because every time if we take the decision this way, that let's go the way majority wants us to go, let's do the way majority wants us to do, then every time it will be their wishes that will be heard, that will be fulfilled. So there should be some fair and rational way of taking their decisions. That is why our wishes could also be fulfilled. Now what happens when such kind of things are there? What happens? There are situations when you want yourself to be heard, when you want your wishes to be fulfilled, but it is not getting so because there are certain restrictions. Now, in this case, constitution plays a major role. In constitution, there are rules and regulations that is not focused on majority or minority. It applies for all the citizens of the country. Now, what happens is like I have two chapters and left to revise because, you know, this girl has her assessment tomorrow and she wants to revise. But it's time for me to watch my favorite TV program and I am dying to watch it. But if I do that, I don't have time left to finish my revision. Now, she was in a dicey situation. She wanted to watch the TV also and she wanted to revise for the exams also. Now, mother and father, they entered and they asked that, Shabnam, why are you looking so worried? So she says that I want to watch TV program, but I have a test tomorrow. If you all watch TV, then even I am tempted to watch it. So let's do it this way that none of us watches the TV today. And that is why I will also feel comfortable. And that is why even I can perform better in my exams. And now the other day when this girl is sitting in the examination hall, she is thinking that, good, I did not watch the TV because there are many questions in this paper which are from the last two chapters, because there were only last two chapters which were left for this girl to revise. What has happened over here? She expressed herself and her wishes were fulfilled.
To watch the complete video, download the Upbind educational app from Play Store and App Store.